captive audience this morning. You got quiet and everybody looked at the screen. That's pretty amazing. At least you know what's going on now. And we're so thankful you're here this morning. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord today? I know sometimes I come in from a long week and I'm just like, I just need some time to get away with Jesus. I need some time with people to encourage me. Thank you so much for being at Remedy Church this morning. If you're here for the first time, we're so glad to have you today. And we hope that you enjoy the service. Would y'all stand with me and let's just welcome the Holy Spirit into the room today by asking Him to come and be with us during this service in prayer. We're going to go into worship. Father, we thank you so much for who you are, God, and we ask today that your Holy Spirit increase in this place. Father, I pray that you would touch each and every person that's sitting in these seats this morning, that your anointing power would sweep across the room, Father. That, God, that you would increase in each and every heart and every life, God, so that when they walk out of this place, they're not the same as when they came in. God, I pray that today would be an impartation of the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit on somebody's life. God, I feel you in the room already this morning. I pray that you would loose shackles, that you would break chains, that you would send healing, that you would give salvation once again as a gift unto every man, woman, and child. God, this morning I ask that as we worship you in spirit and in truth, as we lift you up, that you would draw all men unto yourself. God, that people would see your heart through what your church does today. It's in the precious and holy name of Jesus we pray, and everyone said amen.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where the streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, or walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Blessing you pour my life, serve to when the darkness moves in low, still I will say the blessing be the name of the Lord. Blessing be your name. Blessing be the name of the Lord. Blessing be the glorious name. Blessed be your name, when the sun shines down on me, the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, when the road marked with suffering, the strength in the offering. Blessed be your name. Thank you. blessing be your name. Blessing be the name of the Lord. Blessing be your glorious name. Oh, blessing be the name of the Lord. Blessing be your name. Blessing be the name of the Lord. Blessing be the glorious name. Oh, you give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, oh, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, oh, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name. Blessing be your name. Blessing be the name of the Lord. Blessing be your glorious name.
Not beside me.
is worthy, none beside thee, God Almighty, the great I am. Hallelujah. Holy, holy, God Almighty, the great I am. Who is worthy, none beside thee, God Almighty, the great I am, the great I am, the great I am. Break out.
break out. Get your hands all across the room today. Make that your prayer.
Spirit, break out.
One more time, Spirit, break out.
Spirit, break out.
Break our walls down, Jesus.
Break our walls down.
Spirit, break out.
Spirit, break out.
Heaven, come down.
Heaven, come down.
Jesus, you're the name we're lifting high, your glory, shaking up the earth and skies, revival. We want to see your kingdom here. Do you want that this morning? We want to see your kingdom here. King Jesus, you're the name we're lifting high, your glory. Just the voice of Spirit.
Spirit, break out.
Father, we worship you today. God, in this moment, I pray that the Holy Spirit, that you would reveal Jesus to somebody in the room today. If it's your kingdom we're lifting up, if it's your name that we're lifting up, Father, I pray revelation will come to who needs it this morning. Father, I pray that you would open every heart, every mind in the room. Everyone that has ears to hear this morning, I pray that they would hear the sound of heaven this morning, speaking into their hearts, drawing them out of the darkness and into the marvelous light of Jesus Christ. God, if it's your name that we're lifting up, God, I pray that we wouldn't leave here the same that we came. If it's your name that we're lifting up, and it's not the pastor's name, it's not one another's name, it's not a ministry's name, it's not no other cause's name, but the cause of the kingdom of Jesus Christ that came, that died, was buried and resurrected, and now lives and sits at the right hand of the Father to make intercession for us, Jesus, this morning. If we're lifting you up, God, present us with signs, with miracles, with wonders. God, let us leave in awe of you this morning. God, do something miraculous in this place for someone today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. I want you to find three people, high five them, and tell them you're glad to see them this morning, that it's good to have them in Remedy Church today. With the people of God. I walked out of my house this morning and I'm telling y'all, hell's breaking loose against our church family. Three calls this morning. I'm not going to be here. People who are vital to different things that we were doing this morning, vital to what we do every week. If you'll remember Sister Phyllis this morning, she's actually in the hospital and has been for 2 days with the flu and pneumonia. So please remember her. If you didn't notice, we didn't have a bulletin for you this morning. She does the bulletin every week. So remember her today. Sister Sandy, who was teaching Remedy Kids, is having some gallbladder issues, from what I understand, so she wasn't able to be here this morning. So many of them. My wife is not here. Annabelle has been sick for 3 days now, and today's woke up the worst that it's been so far. But I've got a message for the devil today. That no weapon formed against us shall prosper. That every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord of all creation. Somebody ought to shout and give God some praise in the face of the enemy. Because I know I'm not the only one with a story this morning. They came in here beat up and drug out by the devil this week, and you've got to stand up when the enemy comes against you and declare what thus saith the Lord. Amen? We've got to declare it today. I want to pray for us one more time as we get into the Word. Father, we thank you so much. God, I pray that today that this Word would be quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. God, that you would give us reminders, give us refreshers. God, as we walk out of this place, that we have something to cling to when we go back out into a world that's lost and dying. God, I pray that you would help us to be a reminder of who the church is in today's world. God, not just who we are, but when we come together, that something very powerful happens. And God, as we go out and we disperse, God, that we are a church that doesn't just let out our doors and people walk out, but God, we send. We send people. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Thank the Lord. Today, I want to continue a series. Does it really matter? With the thought, does the church really matter? And if you've got your Bibles with you today, or if you don't, we might have it on the screen. Do we have it on the screen? I've got a verse of scripture I want to read to you. Psalm 34 and 3. It says, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together." Luke chapter 1, verse 46. And Mary said, "The soul doth magnify the Lord." You have to understand something throughout scripture. Is that there has been a song placed inside of your heart that when things are going wrong, there is a song within you that will loose the shackles that have been placed on your life. When you begin to magnify the Lord, things begin to change. And I'm going to get where I'm going in just a second. And I'm going to come back to this word magnify here in just a moment. But I want you to understand before I go any further that whatever you magnify in your life, that is what will be emphasized in your mind. If it's your problem will be the thing that you worry about the most. If it's your problem, that's the thing that is going to be a priority to you in your word and your actions. Amen? So when I think about the word magnify, I think that it is an emphasis on whatever you are focusing on. When you think about the instrument of a magnifying glass, what do? We put it up to whatever we want to see at a closer angle, at a closer perspective. And so you need to know today that whatever you magnify, it is that which people will see in your life and what is emanating from you. Today I want to talk to you about, does the church really matter?
I'm going to try to connect those two the best way that I can for you. But I've got two reasons this morning. I don't have a lot to say to you about the subject matter as far as my notes go, but I'm just going to let the Spirit speak to what I have written down because I've trusted Him with it this morning. Has anybody ever been there? You don't have a fullness or a knowing of what's about to happen, but you just know you have the assurance of the Holy Spirit that He's spoken to you, and this is the direction you're going. Amen? And so I'm going to let the Holy Spirit speak this morning, if that's okay. And I've got two things that I want to talk to you about this morning as to why the church really matters in the Christian life. And so when you begin to look at this, you notice that throughout Scripture, whenever you have the church and the people of God coming together, there are two things that no matter what the ebb and the flow of church is, there are two things that I see that no matter what the enemy throws at the church, that the church exists for. And I'm going to hop right in and tell you that the first thing the church exists for is that the people of God come together and connect with each other. How many of you know that this is vital to the life of the Christian? It is vital to your Christianity. It's vital to your walk with God to connect with other people who are walking the same path as you are. How many of you know that you have walked a life and a path out, that there are people who are not in your circle anymore that you used to run with, and it's because your paths have separated you? So why walk a path if you're going to walk it alone? God did not intend for you to walk out the Christian life alone, sad, depressed, and lonely. He meant for you to connect with the kingdom of God. If I come in and I am adopted as a son or a daughter for the King Jesus, He has supplied me with those that we call brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to remind you today that when I come up to you and I call you brother or sister, it's not because you have earned a title, it's because you have been given a name. It's not because you've earned a position, it's because you've been given a heritage. When I call you brother or sister, it's because we have come into the family of God, that you are a son or a daughter. And just like you are, I am a brother in Jesus Christ. And whether you know it or not, we are all blood related. Amen? I'm thankful for the blood of Jesus that covers everyone that is in the atonement, as the Bible calls it. Everyone who is washed in the blood of Jesus. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. We are heirs to a throne. We are heirs to an inheritance. And we were meant to connect with the people of God. The Bible says that we should connect with those of like, precious, and holy faith. The Bible tells me that we should not forsake the coming together of ourselves as some people do, but as the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ nears, we should do it more and more and more. I'm thankful that I was not meant to walk this life alone. Somebody say amen. That's good preaching, Pastor. Well, thank you. I'll keep on. The people of God are meant to connect with one another. When you get isolated and alone, that's when you get in trouble. Last week, I talked about the waiting seasons that we go through. I talked about the fact that when we get into those waiting seasons, and you've heard people say that sometimes God closes one door and He'll open another, but sometimes you got to wait in the hallway. Have you ever heard of that? And our general overseer, he preaches a message called Hell in the Hallway. And that's what it's like, waiting on God to open the door sometimes. But I'm thankful that I'm not the only one in that hallway. I'm thankful that when I'm walking through the wilderness, He didn't even let the children of Israel be alone when they were walking for 40 years through the desert. No, even though they turned their back on Him, even though they worshipped other images and idols, He still kept His covenant. I'm thankful for a God that came and died for me, yet while I was still a sinner. Thank God Almighty that He's with me. He'll never leave me. He'll never forsake me. And He sends people into my life to carry out His great and divine plan for who I am. I'm thankful for that this morning. The people of God connect with each other. That's one purpose of the church. But a question popped up in my mind when I was studying for this, and the Holy Spirit said, well, who are the people of God? And I said, well, Holy Spirit, that's pretty easy. It's people who are saved, right? And he brought my mind back to everything that's going on in our world today. That question was a lot less complicated 20 years ago. It was a lot less complicated for the children of God to answer who are the people of God 20 years ago, 30 years ago, when church was going to church was the norm. When the thing on Sundays, I can even remember in my lifetime, when I was a teenager, the thing to do was, what's the youth group doing this weekend? Because whatever that was, that's what my plans were. But now we got teenagers running around all over the place trying to find a place that they fit in and that they're accepted. And I'm not speaking down about teenagers. I was one. Don't laugh this morning. It's okay. I used to be one. And it's not their fault that they're scattered and they're running and looking for places to be accepted. The church has failed in bringing in children as they grow up in the fear and admonition of the Lord. It's been enough over the past few years to send them to a class to learn some curriculum, whatever the church is doing, and bring them home and never ask them what they learned and never talk to them about Jesus and never have devotions in your home. I know I'm not the only one that thinks about this sometimes. And we send our children off to classes and they come home and we never talk about church until it's time to get ready the next Sunday. Church, we have got to stop being lackadaisical in our thinking when it comes to the kingdom of God. It is time for the church to rise up and be the church. And the question, who are the people of God, has been diluted by wolves in sheep's clothing. I think that's one of the greatest spirits running around in the church world today, are wolves in sheep's clothing. People who call Him Lord, Lord, and yet their hearts are far from Him. People that lift their hands in worship and then Monday through Friday they can't get a blessing because they're not connected to God. And we end up calling blessings from God, seeing other people experience the power of God. But guess what? God's got a blessing for you too. You just have to submit to what He wants you to do in your life. Man, y'all had to curl your toes early this morning. But the church is to come together and connect with people who are the people of God. They have been marked clearly by His love. You see, I think that there's a quote that I continue to live by that I love. And I know this movie's getting a lot of hate and a lot of mixed reviews right now, but there's a movie called The Shack coming out that was based on a book, and there was a quote in there that really impacted me growing up that said, love always leaves a significant scar. And I've just got to tell you that if you look at the life of Jesus, that you know this is true, that His scars in His hands and feet were the greatest love that we could ever know. And you and I, when we come and we experience Jesus and we get down in an altar and we walk away, we can make a choice to walk away being marked with the love of Jesus Christ or to erase what He's done in the altar and go back out without that mark on us so that the world still accepts us when we're out there. And the church saw that experience we had and they think that we've been marked and so they're good with us on the inside. You see, the devil is after you and trying to get you to think that the greatest thing to happen to you would be for you to be accepted. And all the while, he has distracted you. He has distracted the church. He has distracted people who are supposed to be the people of God with the idea of acceptance. When 2,000 years ago, Jesus died upon an old rugged cross at a hill called Calvary so that you know that you were already accepted in Him if you so choose to come and accept salvation. The people of God are people who passionately live out the standard of God. You see, we want to be a part of a group, of a congregation, of a church, but we don't want to live the standard. We want to be given clout without doing the work. We want to be awarded position without putting in the time. And let me just say this right now. This is not a works-based faith that we're living. We are saved only by faith through grace, right? We're only saved by seeing Him. We're only saved through the blood of Jesus Christ and having faith in Him. And there is nothing that you can ever do outside of confessing and believing that He is Lord to be saved. But I've just got to remind somebody in here today, you were not called to come down to an altar, pray a prayer, and get back up and keep living the same way you used to live, and keep telling people the same old things, and keep being the same old person. You were called to greater. You are no longer normal. You have become an alien, Peter says in his epistle. This is not your home. This is just a world you're passing through. But there are wolves in sheep's clothing that will come along and talk about Jesus, and they will worship Him, or they will seem like they're worshiping Him when they sing the songs and they lift their hands up, and they will come into your corner, and they will come into your home, and they will sit on your couch. And you have met at church, and you have gone together for a while now, and you see them and what they are in church, and yet they come into your home, and all of a sudden your life, which was going good, it starts to fall apart because you've let somebody into your home that has allowed things to come into your life that maybe you didn't bring, but they brought it with them. You have to be careful who you're connecting with in this world. So you need to be able to identify who is loved by the Lord through the grace that He supplies in their salvation. You need to be able to identify who they are by the grace of God that is upon their life. There should be a significant difference between the people of God and the people of the world. There should be a significant difference. We've got all kinds of things going on today, and people, even the church, has begun to say that we need to accept things that are not of God so that people understand the love of God, and they are mistaken in that concept in and of itself because they don't truly understand the love of God if they're willing to accept or fall for anything. Jesus loves everybody, but He does not condone everybody's sin. Jesus loves everybody, but He does not accept someone who has not accepted Him. You have the... that sounded harsh. I know it did, but I've got to preach the truth to you this morning. You have got to understand that if you are going to be included in the church of Jesus Christ, if you're going to be included in the family of God, if you have been adopted into Him, look, my parents, we were talking about this morning in the hallway. My mom likes to go around and tell people that I call her a hypocrite. Because when I was growing up, you better do what mom and dad said or you was going to get a whooping. It wasn't one time, it wasn't two times, it wasn't three times, it wasn't four times asking. You did it or you got a spanking. That's what it was. And, you know, we ain't got to worry about somebody seeing this on YouTube and calling DSS because I'm a grown man now, so I can say that story. But I call her a hypocrite because my son will get in around them. My grandparents already know where I'm going with this. I'll let him get in around them, and he'll start doing things that I that's me. He'll say, it's all right. He's just two. I said, number one, he's almost three. And I said, I swear in 20 years, if you roll out, he's just 21, I'm really going to get on you then. But you can't let God, just like I come into my mom and dad's house, there were rules in my mom and dad's house. There were things that I had to abide by if I was going to be a part of that. And I would hate to think that my mom and my dad would have ever said, look, son, you're going to keep on until you get kicked out of this house and we ain't going to take care of it anymore. But I've got to tell you that there are times, parents, you might have felt this way with some of your kids growing up, and you think, man, I just can't do this anymore. I just can't. I love them, but they've got to figure it out one way or another. Right? And look at this. When you come into the house of God, there is a standard that you must live by. I'm not talking about when you come into the church. Yes, we need to reverence God's house. When I was growing up, you weren't allowed to bring anything but water into the sanctuary. That was it. I'm hitting the hot button. You know, somebody, Brother Ron, come turn the fans. We're going to get hot real quick. We weren't allowed to bring anything but, maybe snacks for babies and water in the sanctuary. That's what it was. That's how it was. There was a standard that was set by the leadership there that people said, this is what's going to happen, and we need to go by it because we want to reverence the house of God. That's all well and good. I'm not talking about the physical house. I'm talking about the people of God. When you get involved with the family of God, there is a standard that you must live by. You cannot go back out and be the same way that you always were. And I know I've said this 5 or 6 times now, but I want to drill it in so that when you leave here, we don't go back out and be the same people that we were. We must be changed. Stephen Curtis Chapman came out a long time ago this was when I was really like 10, 11 years old. This was the first song that we ever participated in Teen Challenge. And he said, what about the change?
You can wear the shirts, you can wear the necklaces, you can carry the Bible, you can sing the songs, you can even go to church religiously. But have you changed? Have you been marked by the love of Jesus? And I don't want anybody to leave here today and say, oh, I brought something because I was wondering if they were made up, sir. So that has to go home. That's all I'm saying. But what I am saying is, church, that we must be a people that's considerate enough for our walk with the Lord. That when you get changed by Jesus, it's not just something that you come down so that you can be a kumbaya. Let's all sit around the fire and we're part of the same group. Praise God that we get to connect with other people. But you're changed by the love of Jesus so that you can go out into a lost and dying world and make a difference. And you have other people, brothers and sisters, that go hand in hand, arm in arm with you, locked up, knowing that you can trust in them to call on them when you need prayer and be an example to those who are around you. Jessica Fuller, a couple of weeks ago, got up and said, and this really touched me, when she said the Lord was talking to her in their situation. And bless God, if you knew, I'm not going to tell the whole testimony, she can, because right now they're in the house that they needed. They got everything that they needed. God's supplying what they need. He is a good God, isn't he, sister? Yes, he is. He comes through for us. He provides what we need. But it's because you are living by a standard. It's because you submit to him when you come to him in prayer, to what he says to do. And we have to be able to answer, who are the people of God if we're going to connect with the people of God? I'm thankful for Remedy Church. Tomorrow will mark 1 year that Megan and I have been here as your pastor. 1 year. And can you think about all the things that we've accomplished in a year? They're a ton. I know some of you may be sitting around and going, well, I ain't seen nothing be done. You ain't been looking hard enough because there's been stuff going on and God is moving. I want you to look around the house today. There are people in this place that wasn't here a year ago. Thank God Almighty for that. There are people in here that were not saved a year ago that are now saved. There are people in here that a year ago, they weren't baptized in the power of the Holy Ghost, but now they're baptized. There were people who were not baptized in water that are not baptized. Change is happening. The church is growing. Our church and churches everywhere. I'm thankful that God said that he would always have a remnant of people who will serve and worship him. I'm thankful for Remedy Church today. And if you're here and you're looking for a family, praise God. I believe you found the people of God. Are we a perfect church? No. We're a flawed church, just like every church out there. But I'm going to tell you what. These people, this person has been changed by the love of Jesus. And he'll change you if you allow him to. We have to connect with other people, the people of God, when we come into God's house. That's the importance of why you need to be here in the church. I don't just, when I call and talk to you, or when I catch you outside of this church building, or wherever we might be, or if I send you a text or a Facebook message, I say, we missed you at church, or I hope to see you this. I don't do it so that we can bolster numbers. I do it because I know that you can't live this life without the church. I do it because I know that you cannot do this thing alone. Husband and wife, you can't do it as a married couple together either. You need other married couples to connect with in God, to come together and say, this is how we want our marriage to be. Don't think just because there's two people in your household that you're okay and you don't need the church. We all need the church of Jesus Christ. This is where we come together. This is where God's grace is supplied. This is where mercies, which are new every morning, are seen. For two purposes that I see for the church. Number one is that we connect with one another. But the second one is that the church is to magnify the Lord. Psalm 34:3, I'm going to read it again. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name forever and together. Luke 1:46 said, and Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord. There is something about when we come together and we begin to emphasize and lift up the name of Jesus, something powerful begins to happen. And in the book of Acts 16, this may be a familiar passage of Scripture to you. And if she can get it up, that would be great. If not, you can just listen to me. I'm a good storyteller. Don't worry. Acts chapter 16, verse 16, it says this, "And it came to pass," this is Paul talking, he is with Silas. And it says, "And it came to pass, as we went to the place of prayer, a certain damsel possessed a spirit of divination and met us." Now, a spirit of divination is a fortune teller, one who is possessed by a spirit that is connecting with the spiritual world to speak the falsehoods into people's lives. I'm going to read it from the ESV version, if that's okay. I like how it says that. In verse 16, just one second. "As we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners much gain by fortune telling." Verse 17, "She followed Paul and us, crying out, 'These men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation.'" Now, that would sound good, but again, she's a wolf in sheep's clothing. It says that she had the spirit of divination upon her, and though she was going around proclaiming that these were men of God, she was doing it. Not her, but the spirit that was inside of her was doing it because it knew that if it could identify who they were, that in this day and age, Paul and Silas would be persecuted by not only the people who were in the city, but they would be taken before the rulers of the city because they were persecuting the people of God at this time. So now that we've got out of this way, it says this, "And this she kept doing for many days." And oh, I love Paul. It said, "Paul having become greatly annoyed." That's real biblical, isn't it? Hey, have you ever heard of a righteous annoyance? "Having become greatly annoyed, turned and said to that spirit, 'I command you in the name of Jesus Christ, come out of her.' And it came out that very hour." I want you to notice there was no waiting, there was no interceding, there was nothing at all. Paul knew who he was in Jesus Christ. He was connected with Silas and those doing the work of the Lord, and as they walked about, things would come to them, and there were many times Paul would walk up and speak to the spiritual world, and he said, "Come out of them, come out of her, come out of there. I know who you are, and you know who I am. I am Paul of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I command you to come out of her." And he said, it left that hour. That was it. The spirit was gone. The kingdom of hell was shut down in that soul because of somebody who rose up and was who they were called to be in that hour for the kingdom of God. And it says this, "But when her owners saw that their hope of gain was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the rulers. And when they had brought them to the magistrates, they said, 'These men are Jews, and they're disturbing our city.'" They didn't say they were of God. They didn't say they performed a miracle. They said, "They're Jews, and they're disturbing our city. They're the people of God, and they're messing our things up. They're the people of God, and they're turning our city upside down. They're the people of God, and they're doing things that we don't like. They're the people of God, and we're persecuting them because we don't agree with them. We're not coexisting with them. We're not doing anything with them, but you know what? They're messing up what we've got going on. It's just like the world today, coming in and standing against Christians. But I've got to tell you that we as Christians have to begin to rise up as the Church of Jesus Christ in this last day and make it known who we are. Because there is a day coming that a man named Jesus will step out of the clouds of glory and onto this earth. And you're going to have to decide who you are. Are you with him or are you with them? It's clear. There are no gray areas on this. The Bible speaks very clearly. And I know, man, I'm telling you, I sound so like hellfire and brimstone this morning. I promise I'm a nice guy. But when the church comes together, hell's going to fight against it. When the church comes together, tactics begin to be loose. Blueprints come to realization of what the enemy has been planning. When the people of God rise up, hell will begin to unleash an organized, strategic attack against the church. Look, he doesn't just try to bum rush the church and take us out. He knows he can't do that because if he's blatant, the church will look at it and say, "Oh, this is nothing but the devil. We better pray." But what he'll do is he'll creep into our homes so that when we come together, the power of the church is not there because the power of the people have been stolen away from them. Hell will fight the church, you, not the church building, but it will fight you every day of your life. So that when you come in here on Sundays, it's just another message. It's just another song. the music wasn't quite right this morning, so I couldn't get into the word. Well, he did all right, but I liked last week's message better, so I could go to the altar with him, and he said some things that I felt like was going to be good to my spirit. Everybody was amen and then more last week, so I felt like the Holy Ghost was there more last week, and so, you know, I went down to the altar, and we all cried and smiled and had a good time. Hello? We have to walk in the authority in God that we have been given. Here's the thing. When the church fights back, hell will stand down. It says this. And when they had brought them to the magistrates, they said, these men are Jews and they're disturbing our city. They advocate customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to accept or practice. And the crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates tore the garments off them and gave orders to beat them with rods. People will always accuse the church of every wrongdoing and flaw that they see to try and de-emphasize what God is trying to do. The church understands and realizes, I hope it does, and let it be known today if you didn't realize this, that the church is flawed. We understand we're not perfect. But the world has this view that all of a sudden, if you consistently begin to come into a building identified as a church, you're all of a sudden one of those people. Amen? Anybody in here been labeled before for your Christianity, for your walk in faith, for believing in God when other people didn't, for trying to explain something to them in faith, but they couldn't see it because they walked by sight? But the people will accuse the church. But I've got to remind you this morning that the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. Jesus looked at Peter, and he said, thou art Peter, and it's upon this rock that I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I am going to give you the keys to the kingdom. You see, we have keys to a kingdom that the enemy cannot overtake. We've got keys to a kingdom to unlock resources to take to problems that nobody else has answers for, that when the enemy throws it in the way of people who are not in God, they're lost and they're without and they don't know what to do. But let somebody who's in Jesus come in with the key and the resource that they need. The resource the enemy didn't count on showing up when he didn't need it to. The people of God are the people who distribute the grace of Jesus Christ into a lost and dying world. Don't you know that Aunt Jo still has that sickness going on because you don't go over there and pray for her enough? That sounds hard. Well, am I supposed to just be the one? Yes, you are. You're supposed to be the person that intercedes for them, to stand in the gap. You're supposed to be the one that prays. You're supposed to be the one that reads. You're supposed to be the one that connects with Jesus on their behalf. And you may not say another word to them, but if you're faithful in what you do for the Lord, God will find His way into their life, and He will present them with an opportunity to accept or reject Him. We have too many Christians that have relied and just laid down and said, I'm just going to do what's good for me and try to keep my own salvation. It's not enough anymore, church, for us to do that. We have been called to go out and get people and drag them out of the pits of hell and down to an altar to accept the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are called to magnify the Lord. People will accuse the church, but hell will never gain on us. We are on assignment wherever we are. Paul and Silas, they were on the way to the place of prayer, but they got drugged into the city square anyhow. It didn't matter what they were on their way to do. They got interrupted by a tactic and an abuse of the enemy toward their life. I want you to see what it says. It said that they tore their garments off and gave orders to beat them with rods. Verse 23 said this, and when they had inflicted many blows upon them, they threw them into prison, ordering the jailer to keep them safely. Verse 24 says this, having received this order, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. They were in maximum security. What they were doing for the name of Jesus Christ was such an offense that they weren't given an outer cell where they could see outside. They were put in the inner prison with the worst of the worst, and they were shackled up, and there was no way for them to get out. But I'm going to remind you what Psalm 34:3 says one more time. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. and let us exalt his name together. Luke chapter 1, verse 46, and Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord. I want you to understand that David wrote Psalm 34 in a place where he was just beat up and wore out. And Mary was in a place where we had just got done hearing about the story of her birthing the Son of the living God. She had been through persecution at this point, and her son was entering into the world and starting to become the man he was called to be. And she said, my soul doth magnify the Lord. And Paul and Silas, they were on the inner side of the prison. They had no way out, and they were shackled up. And guess what they did? Paul and Silas said, we have to pray. If the enemy, let me just tell you this, the enemy is after the unity of the church, because he understands that there is something very powerful when we begin to get together. And Paul and Silas were on the inside of that church, and they're on the inside, I wish it was a church, but they were on the inside of that prison, and they said, we have to pray. And they began to pray and sing, and they said, Lord, we thank you and we praise you. And they began to sing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. No, they didn't, but they sang a song that let out a cry that touched heaven. And I'm going to tell you, the Bible said that once they got together, oh, let me just stop for a second. The enemy, if he was going to do something, he should have put them on the opposite side of town from each other. He should have put them in different cities. He should have put them in different countries. He should have worked it out to where they never would have got together. But he didn't. They were there in jail together, and they said, we're going to pray and we're going to sing. And they said, we thank you and we praise you, Lord. And it says, the Bible said that when Paul and Silas got together, and they began to pray, the Bible said the bands were loosed and the doors were open and the earth shook. And every time I look at Scripture, when the people of God get together and they begin to pray and they begin to sing and the word goes forth, it says the place begins to shake. I wish somebody in Remedy Church would get together and begin to pray and fervently seek God and fervently worship Him and come to church consistently and be involved in ministry and do things outside the four walls, and we would shake a city and turn it upside down. Does anybody want to walk out of jail today?
And begin to pray for me. Yes, I was.
Oh, come and magnify the Lord. Let us exalt His name forever. The devil is after our unity, because if we're scattered, we cannot be organized and structured to accomplish what the kingdom of God is meant for. Something very powerful happens when the people of God come together. They could have been in different places, but they were together. They could have magnified the problem. They could have magnified their scars. They could have magnified their wounds. They could have magnified what had happened to them. They could have magnified and gossiped about that little slave girl that came to them with the spirit of divination. They could have magnified everything that was going on around them. They could have magnified. Look, the church is so worried today about so many things. Should we get tattoos or should we not? Should we wear shorts or should we not? Should we wear dresses or should we not? How short or how long could it be? Should it be down to our ankles, an inch above the knee? Should we wear hair extensions, a wig, a weave? Should we go see this movie? Should we go see that movie? Should we listen to this music? Should I talk to him? Should I talk to her? And all the while that we're worried about all this junk out there, the devil is looking back and he's saying, oh, I got the church occupied.
Well, I like the hellfire and brimstone in the beginning, but I need your amen here too.
Because the church has gotten preoccupied with a bunch of junk that don't matter. It don't matter. Look, when I get to heaven, Jesus is not going to look at me and say, you're wearing shorts today on the day I came back? Are you crazy? He said to present yourself without spot and without blemish. Not without legs hanging open and forearms showing. He said without spot and without blemish. He didn't mention earrings and tattoos. It might look a little different, but I'd rather have a tattooed, sleeved, old, gauged up, piercing old person up here that loves Jesus more than anybody I've ever seen than to have somebody in a three-piece suit trying to tell me they ain't got no sin in their life. Don't make me preach now. Church, we got to get our priorities right. And if people are going to know what God's doing, we've got to begin to identify ourselves as the people of God. Because you know what? Your brother or sister needs you. There's somebody sitting beside you this morning. They're going through hell and high water, and you don't know anything about it. But, oh, but when they look to the side of them and they see you worshiping and lifting your head, this is why you can't be a wolf in sheep's clothing. Because when they look over and they see you with tears running down your face and your hands lifted, and they might just think, man, they're going through some stuff too, but they're praising it anyhow. Oh, they're going through a storm, but they're putting a praise on it. And that's what's going to get them through. And I've got to remember that in the middle of everything in my mess, that I've got a brother or sister in Christ that's got just as big a mess as I've got. You know what? When I'm cleaning up my house and I'm sweeping up the floors, you know what I do? I make little piles of the junk and the trash. And I got one in the kitchen and one in the hallway. And you know what I do at the end? I combine it all up together and I put it all in the dustpan at once and I throw it all away. Sometimes we just need to realize we've all got messes in all different areas. And Jesus will take everybody who's messed up and flawed, and we look like that big pile of junk and dirt sometimes. And you know what? He sweeps it up and he throws it away and never to be remembered, and he makes us clean through his blood. I know that's a silly analogy, but it works. And sometimes you need somebody else who's got just as big a mess as you to go with you down to an altar and remember who you are in God. But we're preoccupied. Oh, by the way, at the end of that thing, verse 25 says, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. And the prisoners were listening to them. These murderers, these liars, these people who were the worst of worst, they were listening to these songs being sung and these prayers being prayed. And it said that suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bonds were unfastened. It wasn't just Paul and Silas that were unfastened. It was all the prisoners that were unfastened. And when the jailer woke up and saw that the prison doors were open, he drew his sword. The enemy that was about to kill them was about to kill himself because he understood that something miraculous had happened. And I just got to tell you that when you're under attack from the enemy, God will turn around and he'll put it back on the enemy himself, where he don't know what else to do but to give way and let Jesus do what he's about to do. And he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried with a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." Now, how many of you see that as weird? Look, it's only 10 till 12. Y'all okay? I just called Michael up here because I was getting tired of just hearing my voice. I need to see this. Y'all thought I was closing. He cried with a loud voice and said, "Don't harm yourself. We're all here." Now, my mind tells me that prisoners, if the door opens, I'm running out. But they all stayed. That tells me right there a change happened in the people that heard the people of God crying out to them. They don't say that. I just like to assume that because I just like to think good things about that stuff. And it says this, "And the jailer called for lights and rushed in. In trembling, with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas. And the man that was tasked to imprison them, that jailer got saved that day." A person that's persecuting you and bothering you, you can be the light of Jesus and the salt of the earth to them, and they'll get saved if you just keep calling. That thing that's bothering you, you just keep calling out the name of the Lord, and it will come into submission under the name of Jesus Christ. That addiction that is being held over you, it'll come under submission in the name of Jesus Christ if you just keep on about it. He got saved that day. So here's what I want to do. The church is for two reasons: to connect with the people of God, and number two, to magnify the Lord.
The Bible says, Jesus said himself, our sin is divided against itself, shall not stand. Where the Holy Spirit is, sin can't be there. Where sin is, the Holy Spirit will not be there. He could if he wanted to, because he's an all-powerful God, but he's not going to be. So I want everybody to sing with me this morning. Every head bowed and every eye closed today. If you'd say, Pastor, you're speaking to me. Worship team, you can begin to make your way up to the stage. I just believe God's going to do something in somebody's life today. You say, Pastor, I want to magnify the Lord. I want to magnify the Lord in my life. I want Him to be number one. I want Him to be the priority. When you guys get up there, you can just bow your head and close your eyes up there. You don't have to do it walking up. I want to magnify the Lord in my life. And look, church, this church depends upon you being right with Him. The work and the ministry of Remedy Church depends on you. You ever thought about that? I don't want to leave this place today without giving you an opportunity. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior today, you say, Pastor, you're a preacher to me. I need to be saved for the very first time today. Would you just lift your hand up? I need to be saved today. I need to know Him. I want my life to be different. I want it to change. You say, Pastor, I've walked away from Him. I've got my priorities all out of whack. I'm thinking about different things. I'm talking and I'm acting on different things that I shouldn't be. My priorities are messed up. I want to come back and know Him. I want to rededicate my life to Him. I've gone my own way. Would you say that's you? Would you raise your hand? I need to give my life back to the Lord. If you're in here today, I want you to give the church the opportunity to be the church. If you have a need today of any kind, whether it be healing, whether it be deliverance from addictions or bondage of any kind, would you just lift your hand up right where you are? I've got a need today. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Hands all across the room. If you were bold enough to lift your hand, would you just come find a place in the altar and begin to pray? I want you to let the church be the church today. If you say, I've come to Remedy Church, I'm looking for a place of acceptance. I'm looking for a place of love where people will minister to me and I can minister to them. I can be a part of a family. If you say, I want to be a part of a family, let the church be the church today. Step out into this altar. Come and get what you need from the Lord. It's not what we do. It's what He does. But we're here to support you. We're a brother. We're a sister in Christ. I'm going to wait for a moment longer. I need some prayer warriors. Prayer chain captains, if you're not up here, come and help me pray. Elders, elders' wives, if you're available. Still have some that need help praying this morning. They need to be lifted up. They need to be encouraged by their brothers and sisters in Christ. I need some prayer warriors. Just stay for me.
To pray for healing. Sister Angie's going to stand in for her mom, who's having surgery Friday, you say? This Friday for cancer that's been in her body. The Bible says, call the elders of the church up to lay hands and pray the prayer of healing. Amen. So I want to say, any family that wants to come up and support and pray, stand in with her. Wow. The church. I said the church is alive and well. You bring me that anointing oil right there. Sister Angie, I'm going to anoint you today. I'm going to anoint this cloth that she's bringing me. I want you to take to your mom. Father, in the name of Jesus, we agree together today as a church family, as the family of this woman of God, Father, we pray that right now the healing virtue would flow over her body. God, from the top of her head to the soles of her feet, wherever this cancer is, God, I pray that your hand would touch her every place, God. I pray that you would touch this medical center. God, as they perform what you have called them to do, and you have given them the gifts to do. Father, that you would touch them, God, and your might can be upon them. Father, we trust you in whatever channel healing comes. God, and we pray that right now that miracles, signs, and wonders would be apparent in her life. Father, I pray that you would be strong in this moment. God, that she would carry the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and as we pray over this wall, it is a symbol, God. There's nothing in the cloth, there's nothing in this oil, but God, it's a symbol of your love and the power of this one of your Holy Spirit. If we sin with her, God, we believe in your partation, and we impart the Holy Spirit and his power with her as she walks in the Spirit to go meet her mother. Father, I pray that you would bring her touch and her mother, God, that you would come. Bless the assurance of what you're doing in your life. I need the name of Jesus to command every demon in hell to God, the enemy be vanquished in the name of Jesus. God, the Lord, loose the heavenly armies to surround her during this time of her life. God, that you would bind up his enemies in the way, God. They would have to go down in their mind that the Lord is good and greater to increase. God, as I said and done, let this not be a moment of the walk around and run away and sin with all the other and say, let's Lord, let us exalt his name together. My soul doth magnify the Lord. I said, my soul doth magnify the Lord. My soul doth magnify you, Lord, in all the earth. Remember that afterward we have a table set up outside of Hebrews Cafe. If you have any contributions to make to our Better to Give project for baby girls ages 0 to 3, you can do so there. Sister Robin's going to be standing at that table for the next 10 to 15 minutes after service. Let's also be sure to stop by there. It made my heart glad to see when I walked in. That table was full and bags were sitting behind it. And we're going to do it, church. Amen? We're going to do it. We're going to wreck our city for Jesus. I believe it. Remember that. Be with us on Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. We're going to wrap up our series, Five Lies That Ruin Relationships. And the following Wednesday, we're going to begin a study on spiritual warfare. So I just want to let you know now, if you're interested in that, be with us on Wednesday nights. forgetting anything, anybody? Sister Phyllis is usually over here, and I look at her, and she'll go, you forgot this, or you forgot that. She's like, today is the National Day of Prayer, yes. Find a time of prayer, a place of prayer, and get down there. And seek God for our nation, for our leadership, for everything that's going on in our lives, and for your family. Let's be a church that's a healthy church, a church that wants to do great things for God. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. God bless you as you go, and we'll see you on Wednesday.